Welcome to Stories and Sips. I'm Barry Chandler in the beautiful Glenshillane Woods near Capoquin in County Waterford. You can hear the river bubbling behind me. I'm just finished a nice hike with my dad through the forest here. Beautiful day, cold, but the sun is shining, so we can't complain. I'm in County Waterford, as I said, home right now of two maybe of the most interesting distilleries and whiskey approaches in Ireland currently. And yesterday I had the privilege of spending almost 7 hours in one of these distilleries learning about what they do, and I'm still processing it 24 hours later. And in this episode of Stories and Sips, I want to share my thoughts, my opinions, and my perspective on what this new approach or exciting approach is doing for the Irish whiskey world. So if you were to start a distillery today in Ireland, if you wanted to go to the expense of building a whiskey brand, the considerable expense of building a distillery, obviously whiskey is a long-term play. It takes years to mature, many years to build a brand and to be known in the marketplace. And so for many distilleries, while they're waiting for their whiskey to mature, if they've managed to invest or raise enough money or spend enough money to be able to afford the barley and the stills and the distillery itself, they're going to need to make money. You're going to need to make money waiting for that whiskey to mature. Perhaps you distill gin and vodka in the meantime. Perhaps you source third-party spirit, third-party whiskey that you can sell yourself, maybe under your own label. And when you're distilling, you may look for all of the efficiencies that you can during fermentation and distillation and maturation, so that eventually you're going to be able to make, hopefully, a return on your investment. Now, you could do all those things, and they're all perfectly acceptable. Widely done in Ireland, contract whiskey is widely sourced. And certainly gin and vodka are used to keep the lights on for distilleries while they wait for their whiskey. But what if you looked at all those things and you said no? Defiantly and confidently you said no. We're not going to distill gin or vodka. We're going to focus solely on whiskey. And in fact, we're going to take the processes of fermentation and distillation and maturation, and rather than look for efficiencies, rather than look for ways to do it as cost effectively as possible, we're going to break each step down into maybe 100 different steps. And then we're going to analyze each of those 100 steps. And we're not going to look for efficiencies within those 100 steps. We're not going to look for cost savings. Rather, we're going to ask ourselves why at every single step. We're going to ask ourselves, why is it done this way? And then we're going to push ourselves to optimize each step so that it is not the cheapest or fastest, quickest, but rather it's the best step towards this end vision. In doing that, of course, it'll take longer, it'll cost more, it'll certainly create far more work for a distillery team, and there's still no guarantees at the end that you're going to get something that people will actually want to drink. But what you have here in that second example of going that, not just the extra mile, but that extra marathon, what you have is Waterford Distillery, where I had the privilege of spending 7 hours yesterday with the team, with the head distiller Ned and with Megan, who kindly took me in for what I thought was going to be naively an hour or 2 hours in their company. No, it was 6 to 7 hours where they broke down every single aspect of their business, of before fermentation, the sowing of the seeds, the growing of the barley, the collecting of that barley. Waterford Distillery is doing something that very few distilleries or whiskey brands could do, want to do, or could afford to do. And in doing so, they're making a massive, massive bet that what's going to come out the other end, 5 years perhaps after the first distillation, is going to be the best, the most complex single malt whiskey that the world has ever seen. That's their bet. Now, the Waterford Distillery has only been around for, I think now, what's about 4 years, and it is the largest distillery in Ireland by a country mile that hasn't yet released a product. They've been distilling non-stop for the past 3.5-4 years. They have 4.5 warehouses full of whiskey maturing, none of which has seen the light of day yet. Now, in the next 6 months, we may see something come out of that distillery. But their approach, their belief that first of all, that the best barley in the world grows in the southeast of Ireland is one of their immovable beliefs. Mark Rainier, the founder of Waterford Distillery, formerly of Brookladdock Distillery in Scotland, was famously told that the southeast of Ireland grows the best barley. So he's come to Waterford and he's put a stake in the ground and he said, well, if you're growing the best barley, we should take care of this barley and we should do our best to not mess with this barley. We should take care of it. We should distill in a way that pays homage to not just the barley as a grain, but to its provenance, its source, its what they're calling its terroir. And Waterford Distillery could be summed up by three words that they use themselves: terroir, traceability, and transparency. Terroir meaning literally of the earth. What is the difference? What are the unique qualities of a product because of its place, because of its earth, because of its soil, its weather conditions, its geographic location, everything that happens to the product, to the grain, to the soil contributes to a unique terroir. And the argument, which isn't really an argument, you could take it really from my perspective, is it's pretty much fact that things growing in one geography will taste different to things growing in another geography, even if the barley variety is the same, even if the time in the soil is the same, because weather conditions are going to vary slightly from geography to geography, the topography, the soil type are all going to vary slightly. But terroir is one of the three pillars, the three-legged stool of Waterford Distillery. And so they think, and they're making a bet, that not only are different geographical areas or regions of Ireland different, but farms within the same region are different. And so Waterford has focused on farms, individual farmers and their crop. And they've gone to the trouble, the immense trouble, of redesigning how the mashing and, or not the mashing, the malting of barley takes place. So rather than having 20 farmers who contribute all of their barley to a malting company where it's malted in the aggregate and then given to a distillery, Waterford Distillery has gone in a different mad direction where they have had to have malting companies redesign how they work. Waterford Distillery has a separate distillation for every farm. So if you have 28 farms, you have the barley sown, you have the barley collected individually, you have the barley stored individually, you have the barley distilled individually, so that at the other end, what comes out of the still is the product of one single farm, which means not only could you have a single malt, not only could you have a single cask, but you could have a single farm, which means you could trace the whiskey all the way back to a farm. And that's the second T, traceability. Every single step of the process, from the sowing of the seed to the bottling of the whiskey, is absolutely traceable. In fact, I saw 150 data points, I'd say at least, all along the way. Temperatures, license plates of the trucks that went to pick up the barley, time in the ground. I mean, the level of detail is astronomical. So this traceability, I think, is going to become very, very important in Irish whiskey, and it's something that many of the big distilleries don't want to talk about because it's expensive. And it's also going to shed light on the fact that many distilleries use non-Irish grain, and they have to do so maybe because of volume, but that's not a story that's often told. With Waterford, it's 100% traceable back to the farmer, and that's something that's really interesting. And then the third T is transparency. There was nothing I couldn't have seen yesterday in Waterford if I hadn't asked for it. Books were opened, computer programs were opened, any question I wanted answered was answered. There's complete transparency about what's happening. And what that's doing is it's creating its own narrative, it's creating its own story that doesn't need a marketing agency to come in and invent a story. Because the story of farm, literally farm to glass, is such a compelling story. Why? Because we're celebrating the farmers of Ireland. Is there anything that's more Irish than the Irish farmer? Waterford has been releasing incredible videos over the past year where they talk to the farmers who share their passion for growing crops, and you see their kids running around the farms with them, around the fields, helping out. It's such an Irish scene, but it's something that's so marketable too, because as I think about what I do in the United States with my whiskey tastings and introducing Irish whiskey to Americans, is there a more Irish story than being able to show from which farm, the story of the farming family, their stories, their narrative, leading all the way through to this whiskey in this bottle. Think of the pride that farmer will have eventually when he or she sees their bottle on a shelf in Waterford or in Saigon. There's no end to the stories that will come out of this approach. Terroir, traceability and transparency. I tasted some of the liquid in the warehouses that's only been aging now for about 3.5 years. And typically when you get a 3.5-year-old whiskey, you're tasting, you've got this distillate forward, harsh, often harsh mouthfeel and impact on the throat as you swallow it. None of that's present in the distillate from Waterford. Why? Because when I mentioned that they're doing everything differently and they've broken down the 100 steps of fermentation, distillation, maturation, rather than taking advantages of the efficiencies of the size of their tanks, the size of their stills, the speed at which they could distill, they've rather said, no, we'll distill slower. We won't distill at capacity. We'll take our time. Layer that on top of a wood program where they're spending 30% of their budget on wood. I saw Chateau Lafite Rothschild wine barrels that they're using. They're sourcing the most expensive woods, pairing that with a slow approach to distillation, a slow approach to growing, a slow approach to fermentation. In fact, they've even gotten rid of enzymes in the fermentation stage that typically speed up fermentation. Rather, they say, we don't want anything interfering with the barley and with its natural, the natural fermentation process. So when you put all these things together, it's no surprise that what you taste on the other end is a remarkably different whiskey. Now, what Waterford are doing is going to, it's really going to piss a lot of people off. Why? Because it's going to shine a light on what is possible when there are no budgetary restraints, when there doesn't seem to be many budgetary restraints in Waterford, to be honest. They must have great investors. What's possible when you focus on 100% Irish, from the sourcing of the grain to, every aspect of it is 100% Irish. It's going to shine a light on distillation methods, on sourcing of grain. It's going to shine a light on, I think consumers are going to ask more of their favorite whiskey companies, and that's going to, I think it's going to elevate, raise the bar, which for consumers is a great thing. For whiskey companies, I think they're going to have to get ready and they're going to have to figure out how do they meet the demand if it should come from what Waterford are doing. Now, of course, all of this is unproven. There's no liquid in a bottle, there's no bottle on a shelf, and there's no liquid in people's bellies, and no feedback really from the general public to say what this tastes like. I will say that I have tasted this liquid, I've tasted varietals of the whiskey, and I don't think I've been as excited about a new whiskey since I got into Irish whiskey a few years back. So for me, Waterford Distillery they're changing the game. I don't think there is a category that they could fit into. Irish whiskey is almost too broad a category. They're doing something that's very different. Single malt whiskey is all they're going to produce. You're going to see varieties that include many farms married together to create maybe a Waterford region of whiskey. You're going to see really interesting wood programs and kind of wood finishes and maturations coming out of Waterford. So I'm excited to see this in people's hands, and that's really going to be the big test, isn't it? But from my perspective, they're doing something that maybe is long overdue. They are bold. They are not afraid to say what they think. They have very strong beliefs. They have a position. You either are going to like it or you're not. I personally like a strong opinion. I also like an underdog, somebody coming in saying, actually, I think there's a better way, because that raises the bar for everybody. So to Mark Rainier and the team, to Ned and to Megan and all the team who were very kind in giving me so many hours of their time yesterday to show me what they believe and what they are all about, I didn't realize the level of detail that they were going to in Waterford Distillery. So keep an eye out. Do what you can to get your hands on some of this when it gets on the shelves, to see for yourself whether terroir and traceability and transparency matter. To those that they do matter, then Waterford is going to be their drink for a long, long time to come. So I'm looking forward to seeing it on the shelves. I've got a couple of samples I'm going to go taste now. So to Waterford Distillery, Cheers.